Right. So, hello, everyone. My name is Sergey Smalkov. I'm a professor at the New Economic School, and our new campus building is in my background. So, you're welcome to visit school physically. And I'm very glad to host this particular lecture. And the lecture itself is going to be in English on Zoom. And you can switch to Russian translation if you click on the globe icon at the bottom of the Zoom screen. Наша лекция будет проходить на английском языке. И если вы хотите послушать ее на русском, то на него можно переключиться, нажав иконку с глобусом внизу экрана Zoom. И та же функция доступна в мобильном приложении Zoom. Ну или подключиться к русской трансляции на YouTube. So the same function is available in the mobile version of Zoom, or you could connect to the Russian or English translation, English translation of the lecture in YouTube. And the links are in the chat. And then you'll find the video of this lecture, which has been recorded, and the past lectures, along with all kinds of materials on economics, finance, and education, at the NES popular science website Guru, and the link to that website you can also find in the chats. We would especially like to thank our partner Safmar Charitable Foundation that kind of generously provided support for this lecture series and other NES public lectures. And all our kind of popular science projects are free for the audience. And we would be very grateful and happy if you also join and support us so we can continue these public activities and continue inviting superb, very interesting and distinguished speakers and organize the lectures and present materials. And again, if you'd like to support us, the link to how you can do that will appear in the chat. So, Haluk, welcome to this floor. We are so happy to have you here with us. I'm particularly happy because we've been colleagues at MIT, and your research is extremely high quality. It's super valuable, and the topic of this lecture is living organ exchange and what lessons for market efficiency can we learn from research here. And Haluk is the present professor of economics at UC Berkeley, and previously he graduated from Princeton, had been a professor at MIT, at Washington University in St. Louis, at Duke, and had numerous contributions in the broad areas of game theory and domain design, specifically in decision theories and market design. And I would say one of the most original thinkers of our generation, and published in top journals, including ER and then Econometric. You can find this video of Haluk in the chats as well, if you'd like to learn more and read his papers. And just last note is that, feel free to ask questions during the talk, especially if it's clarifying questions. And then at the end of the talk, I will, some of you will already ask questions over YouTube and in the chats and in all other means possible. And we, at the end of the lecture and of the applications, will give a prize to the best question. So this is a prize from our partner Bookmate for the most interesting question. And so please ask questions. And then usually our audience ask remarkable questions. So very different topics and aspects related to the talk. And so I'm actually personally looking forward to those questions and hope Haluk will too. And so without further delay, my great pleasure to give the floor to Haluk. And Haluk, please.
Thank you very much, Sanye, and thank you very much for the invitation. So let me share my screen. Second. Does it look fine? All right. So today I'm going to talk about research that I've done with my colleagues Tayfun Sönmez and Utku Ünver at Boston College. And the topic of this is how should we organize an efficient and incentive compatible labor exchange. And before actually I start talking about this topic, I think it will be useful to talk about organ donation and organ exchanges in a more broad sense. So, let's see. So when we think of living donor organ transplantation, what we mean is basically the removal of an organ from a healthy living donor and its transplantation to a patient whose organ is failing. And standard examples or well-known examples of this is perhaps the most well-known is kidney donation. Since a healthy individual has two kidneys and can survive actually with only one, it is possible for a healthy individual to donate one of his kidneys or her kidneys to a person suffering from kidney disease. And living donor organ transplantation is a term as opposed to deceased donor organ transplantation, because it's also possible in certain cases for deceased donors to also donate their organs to patients whose organs are failing. And as I mentioned, the kidney is the most well-known example. And one of the reasons is because it's a very frequent the living donor transplantation is done in very large numbers. And the second organ for which such transplantations are done is actually liver. Liver is a little bit different in the sense that everybody has one liver. So you can't donate, if you're a living healthy individual, you can't donate all your liver. But part of this liver that we call, I will explain later more precisely, that we call lobes, can be donated in a safe way to a patient whose organ is failing. And you might be familiar. Perhaps, you know, even if you're not familiar with organ living donor organ donation, you might be familiar with blood donation, right? We know that there are certain restrictions in blood donation. Not everybody can donate their blood to everybody else. For example, if I have an O blood type, then I might donate to all other blood types. But if I have an A blood type, then I cannot donate to a B blood type or an O blood type. So in particular, organ donations as well are going to have blood type compatibility restrictions. So not everybody will be able to donate their organ because due to these restrictions. And depending on the organ type as well, there might be some additional restrictions. So for instance, when we think of kidney transplantation, there are some other more technical tissue compatibility restrictions. And when we think about liver transplantation, there is going to be a size restriction. I'll make this more precise, but the general idea is that every patient is going to require a minimum size kidney transplantation. Very good. And what we want to talk about is organ exchange. And what do we mean by this term is basically assume that, for example, my organ is failing and my sister is willing to donate her organ to me. This could be, again, as an example, you could think of it as liver or think of it as kidney. It is possible that actually maybe we have some incompatibility, so it's not possible for her to donate to me. So in that case, what could be done is we could consider different pairs consisting of such incompatible patient-donor pairs. So let's look at this picture, for instance, if you look at the top row represents two individuals. Say donor one is my sister, and recipient one is me, and she actually wants to donate to me, but due to this incompatibility, she cannot. And to illustrate this, we use this red arrow with a that's crossed across it, so it's impossible for her to donate to me because of these restrictions. But that could be another such pair, another patient donor pair is in the lower row that suffers from the same issue, that the intended donor cannot directly donate to intended recipients. Nevertheless, you know, it is theoretically and also practically possible that perhaps the second donor is able to donate to the first patient, and the first donor is able to donate to the second recipient. If this is the case, then these two pairs can get together and exchange their donors, and in this way, both of these incompatible pairs are able to achieve a successful transplant. So this is the example of a living donor organ exchange. And this particular example is called a two-way exchange because we are only considering two pairs. It's a total of four individuals, but the two-way refers to the fact that we have two pairs. And in particular, this idea could be generalized even further. We don't have to restrict attention to only two-way exchanges. We could also consider larger length exchanges. And as an example, let's think of a three-way exchange. So consider three pairs of incompatible patient donor pairs. So we could have a three-way exchange if these three conditions are satisfied. So for instance, if D1, the first donor, is able to donate to the second patient, the second donor is able to donate to the third patient, and the third donor is able to donate to the first patient. If all these are possible, then actually these three pairs can get together, and at least in theory, can achieve a transplant for all these three patients. And however, there is one issue here that is a kind of a logistical challenge to implementing these organ exchanges. And the issue is the following. It is not going to be possible to do these three donations that is listed in this slide in a sequential manner. The reason is the following. If suppose that we do these in order, so first, the first day on Monday, D1 donates to P2, the second day on Tuesday, D2 donates to P3, and on the third day, on Wednesday, D3 donates to patient one. And if this is the plan, and suppose to implement this, at this start, each donor signs a contract saying that, for example, donor two signs a contract saying that if donor one donates to patient two on Monday, I will donate to patient three on Tuesday. The issue with such a contract is that it's not binding. So for instance, if donor two, after signing this contract, on Monday, donor one donates to patient two, and Tuesday comes, donor two can always say, actually, I'm not going to abide by this contract. And it's going to be a legally non-binding contract. So, and of course, at that stage, when Tuesday comes, donor two, in fact, has an incentive to walk away from this contract. Why is that? Because patient two, who donor two cares about, has already received his transplant. So donor two actually has no reason to stay in this, abide by this contract. So this feature makes a sequential implementation of these two-way or three-way or in general N-way exchanges impossible in practice. As a result, if you want to implement, say, a three-way exchange, the only feasible scenario under this legal restriction is to have all these operations at the same time. So if you're going to implement, say, a two-way exchange, then you're going to need four operating teams for extracting the organs from the donor, then two for extract for transplantation of these organs to the patients. So if you're thinking about the three-way exchanges in this example, then you're going to need six operating teams, six operation rooms. So as you can see, of course, as the size of the exchange increases, the implementation of that exchange becomes more and more difficult because of the simultaneity restriction. So in practice, in many examples of organ exchange, it is reasonable and it is actually pretty much the only reasonable thing to think about almost about two-way exchanges, because two-way exchanges are actually the logistically simplest form of such organ exchanges. Of course, allowing for larger size exchanges can in principle lead to an efficiency gain, but due to this logistical constraint, typically it is not studied as well. And in particular, in our paper as well, we are going to restrict attention only on these two exchanges. And there is a large literature on organ exchanges, and kidney exchange is the one that is most well studied. And I apologize ahead, since the literature is very large, I might be missing a lot of other important contributions, but let me point out at least the highlights from these existing literature. So in kidney exchange, for instance, Rapaport was the initial person who suggested that the potential gains from implementing a kidney exchange. So he was the person who proposed this idea. And Roald Sommers and Ulmer, in a series of papers, they introduced optimization, matching and market design techniques for implementing kidney exchange. There are several other important contributions that because of the time constraint, I won't go into very much detail. Since we will study liver exchange, then we'll emphasize a few of the contributions in liver exchange. So Huang et al, they did propose the idea and documented the practice in Korea for liver exchange. Chen et al did the same thing for Hong Kong, and Mishra et al studied the idea in the US and proposed the organization of a centralized liver exchange clearinghouse. Also, in another paper with Taifun and Utku, we've studied multi-donor organ exchange. So there are certain organs that require multiple donors. So a single donor is not sufficient. And one particular example is lung. The logistics of those exchanges are a little bit more complicated. That's related literature. Another related literature is one that actually puts together the exchange of different organ types. For example, in trans-organ exchange, you might consider as in these papers, putting together both liver and kidney exchanges within the same market. So for example, a pairwise exchange may consist where one second pair's donor donates his liver to the first patient, and the first pair's donor donates her kidney to the second patient. And in transorgan exchange, decreases in Sandman, for instance, studying the additional gains that may be achieved by putting together multiple different organ types. All right, so let's go a little bit more into the specifics of liver. And so liver has, as an anatomic structure, has eight small lobes that you can see in this picture. And those lobes are broadly categorized into two sets. The right section of the liver consists of these four lobes. So the right section is to our left right now. So these sections 5, 6, 7, and 8, those small lobes altogether, make up what is called the right lobe. And these four lobes, 2, 3, 4A and 4B, make up what is called the left lobe of the liver. So typically, the left lobe is about 30 to 40% of the total size of the liver, and the right lobe is about the remaining 60 to 70% of the liver. So you should think of right lobe as being this collection of lobes that is the larger part of the liver, which is about 60, 70%, and the left liver is the other part. As I mentioned at the start a little, the liver is the second most common organ for transplantation. If you look at numbers in the US from 2018, there was a total of approximately 8,000 liver transplantation. Most of these liver transplantations were from deceased donors. Only 400 came from transplantation from living donor organs. If you want to contrast kidney versus liver transplantation, although kidney transplantations are larger in number, significantly larger in number, organ end-stage kidney failure has some alternative treatments. Although it's not very desirable, if you have NDA end-stage kidney failure, dialysis could still be an alternative treatment to transplantation. But transplantation is more critical or more important for a person who has end-stage liver disease because there is no such alternative treatment. So the only treatment for end-stage liver disease is transplantation. So we have to give us another reason to take this problem more seriously. And how are these liver transplantations made? As I mentioned, everybody, as we know, everybody has one liver, so we can't donate the whole organ. The possibilities, there are two types of transplants, basically, done in practice. You can either take the left lobe out of the donor, which is the smaller 30 to 40% size lobe. And this is called the hepatectomy, the left hepatectomy operation. So hepatectomy is basically extraction of part of the liver from the donor. Or you could extract the right lobe, which is the larger size portion of that liver. That is called the right hepatectomy. So there are these two modes of operation, two modes of donation of liver. And then of course, after you extract, do the hepatectomy operation, you do transplant that part of that organ to the patient. And one of the features of liver, as opposed to kidney, for instance, if the operation is successful, if the hepatectomy is successful, and there are no other complications, actually the liver regenerates. So it can go back to its full size. So that's kind of good news. Very good. Now, how should we think, between right versus left hepatectomy operations? So it turns out that actually right hepatectomy, so it's extracting the larger part of the liver organ from the donor, is much riskier for the donor. And there are multiple measures to see this. The first measure is that right hepatectomy leads to higher mortality rates for the donors. So, and you can see from these numbers right here, the risk of donor mortality in left hepatectomy is 0.1%, whereas with right hepatectomy, that number is 0.5%. So there's a fivefold increase in the probability of death, donor death, if you do right hepatectomy versus left. But not just that, there might also be other non-death related complications. So for instance, these are called the morbidity. So morbidity is essentially the possibility of other surgery related complications that the donor can suffer from. And the donor morbidity rates are also much higher, as you see from these numbers, about fourfold if you do right hepatectomy versus left hepatectomy. And yet, as if this is not enough, when you compare right versus left hepatectomy, not only these complication probability is higher, but also the complications are more severe. So it turns out that that is the case as well. So overall, when you look at these evidence, it is clear that, you know, if it is possible, we must prefer right hepatectomy to left hepatectomy. So it must be preferable, at least from the donor's health perspective, to extract this, you know, left lobe rather than the right lobe from the donor. However, as we will see, there are going to be, we might face reasons for which actually right hepatectomy may have other desirable features. So let's see. And we can see that by looking at the donation compatibility requirements. As I mentioned in the beginning, liver has two compatibility requirements. One is the standard blood type compatibility requirement, and another one is a size requirement, a minimum size requirement. So the blood type compatibility requirement, you can see by looking at this graph. Again, you probably know this is the same graph which says that so we have four blood types here. So we have O, A, B, and AB blood types. And the arrows shows who can, which blood types can donate to which blood types. So for instance, of course, O can donate, every blood type can donate to itself. That's why we have these self-pointing arrows for each of these blood types, as well as the blood type O can donate to every other blood type, as you see. B can donate to, of course, itself, and AB, similarly for A, and AB blood type can only donate to itself. So these blood type restrictions are also restrictions in organ exchange. For instance, an A blood type person cannot donate part of his liver to a B blood type person. The other restriction is the size compatibility restriction. And broadly stated, every patient requires a donation that is at least 40% the size of the liver of that patient. So every patient requires at least 40% size of the original liver of that person. So the graft must be at least that size. So in particular, again, if you go back to the example of my sister trying to donate to me, since she's a smaller person than me, you know, her liver reasonably might also be smaller than me. And her donating her left liver to me may be infeasible, not just because of blood type constraints, but also because of the size constraint. So as a reason, as a consequence, if smaller people want to donate to a larger people, they may need to go through this riskier right hepatectomy operation. So although right hepatectomy is clearly undesirable, as we argue, it may be the only way we can do a transplant in certain circumstances. Now, let's talk about preferences of the patient-donor pairs. So what I mean by this is there are different things that could happen to a patient-donor, an incompatible patient-donor. I'm only going to study in this presentation incompatible patient-donor pairs for simplicity, although the original paper actually is a much more general treatment, also allows for the study of compatible patient-donor pairs as well, among other things. So if we have an incompatible patient-donor pair, then if we look at their preferences over participating in different forms of exchanges, we're going to assume that they always prefer to participate in an exchange where the donor donates her left lobe compared to participating in an exchange where the donor donates her right lobe. Again, going back to the example with me and my sister, if my organ is failing and my sister cannot donate to me because of, say, blood type constraints, then I'm going to prefer, or as a pair, we're going to prefer the healthier option for my sister, in the sense that we're going to prefer participating in an exchange where my sister donates her left lobe compared to participating in an exchange where my sister donates her right lung. And that's a very natural assumption, as we say, because of the objectively measured risks of this operation. That is the only reasonable preference to have. However, there is one more thing that a preference should specify. And this is something that is not observable. It's a subjective assessment of the care. And what is that? Well, obviously, if we come up with an instance where the only possibility for us to participate in an exchange is through my sister donating her right lung. So if this is the only possibility that we have, so what does that mean? That means that we will either participate in an exchange and I will get a transplant from a different pair's donor, but my sister will have to go through this risky right lobe hepatectomy operation. Or we will just not do anything. I will not get a transplant, but my sister is going to be, of course, we might have to go through taking that risk. So the problem is it's not clear how a pair should weigh this trade-off. So in this case, I might just go and say that, I'm sorry, we can't do this. It's too risky for you. So as a pair, I'm not going to accept. I don't find this acceptable that you donate your right lung. It's too risky for you. But if the situation was reversed, you could also imagine a different situation. So for example, my child is suffering and I need to donate to her. And in that case, if I cannot directly donate to her, I might just find it quite acceptable to donate my right lobe if that's the only way that this transplantation is going to work, this exchange is going to work. So depending on the personal preferences of this pair may be willing to take that extra risk for the donor, or they may be unwilling to take that extra risk of going through right hepatectomy for that pair's donor. And formally, willing pairs are going to rank the option of not participating in a pairwise exchange above this option two. And what we call unwilling pairs, those who do not want to take the risk of right hepatectomy for the donor, are going to rank the participation in this pairwise exchange option. Sorry, I might have said it wrong. Let me repeat. The willing pairs are willing to take the risk. So they're going to rank the non-participation option at the very bottom. And the unwilling pairs are going to rank the non-participation option between one and two. So these are basically two potential preferences that a pair can have. And this is not a physical thing. It is just about personal preferences, about how this pair weighs the risks and benefits of this right lobe hepatectomy. There's a technical term for this that we use a lot in economic theory called private information, meaning that the particular, whether the pair is willing or unwilling, is their private information. That means that it's not something that is observed by an outsider. So for example, if you want to design a mechanism, a method for a clearing house to form exchanges, given a collection of incompatible pairs, then the person who implements these exchanges will not be able to directly see whether a given pair is willing or unwilling, and has to rely on that pair's report identify their preferences. So that is the reason it's called private information. It's something that is only known by the pair and not observed by an outsider. Now, I want to discuss a simple model. If you look at the paper, it's a relatively technical paper. It's full of notation. It may be a little bit difficult to grasp if you haven't worked on economic theory before. I'm going to try to not use any notation. So what I'll do is I'll introduce a simple model. And this simple model is going to be, again, much simpler than the one presented in the paper. So if you wonder about ways in which this could be generalized. A number of those generalizations are already in the paper, but hopefully this simple model is going to give us some intuition regarding how such a market can be designed, such a centralized clearinghouse. So here we're going to assume, start by assuming that we have a fixed collection of incompatible patient-donor pairs who participate in a liver exchange clearinghouse. So imagine that we have these pairs, the donors of each of these pairs are unable to donate to the patient of that pair, and with hopes of going to participating in exchanges, they do come to this clearinghouse. And we're going to have a clearinghouse administrator who observes all these incompatible patient-donor pairs. What does the clearinghouse administrator observe? We will assume that the clearinghouse administrator observes all physical aspects of the participating patients of donors, patients and donors. What I mean by this is that a clearinghouse administrator will be able to see the blood types, the sizes of the left and right lobes of the potential donors, and the graft size required by each patient. So these are objective information. This is verifiable information. So it is reasonable to assume that a clearinghouse administrator, by contacting the doctors or the hospitals who work with these patient donor pairs, can get access to this information. However, as I mentioned, the particular preferences of these pairs, whether they are willing or not, this is their private information, and it's not something that's objectively accessible. As a result, the clearinghouse administrator has to rely on these pairs' announcements of whether they are willing or not, since they cannot access that information directly. And the matching mechanism is going to put together all these observable and announced information regarding preferences to create a collection of pairwise exchanges. Of course, these pairwise exchanges have to be feasible in the sense that it has to be consistent. So if we say that the two pairs are going to will participate in the pairwise exchange, we've got to ensure that the compatibility requirements are met. And also, the administrator has to specify if there's an exchange, whether each donor donates their left or right lobe. So they go to the left or right. So this is the general model. And our objective is to come up with a nice matching mechanism. And what do I mean by a nice matching mechanism?
Yeah, hello, just a second. Yes. A small clarifying question, actually opportunity if there's other questions to ask. It's from Kenny. Should we write at this moment, considering this possible set of patients and donors, also consider disease donors and that the administrator kind of can use those? Or it's better to, I know that in extension that's possibly feasible and things, but should we think in terms of this simplified model, is this also a part of the model or not?
That is a very good question. So although we do a lot of other generalization in the current paper, we haven't looked at that. But there is certainly, one can see that, and it's been done actually already for the kidney exchange. It is possible to incorporate both living donation and deceased donor donation within the same model. And that is actually the right way of doing this. So it is a good question. We haven't looked at it yet. But it's a question that has been asked in the context of kidney exchange. And would you believe that one of the next steps in this research agenda corresponding to liver is also to understand that question? And perhaps not just that, there's an additional similar component to that. There are also sometimes people who are willing, even they are not deceased, they don't have a potential patient they're associated with. Nevertheless, they are benevolent people who just want to do good to the society, and they donate these people are called good Samaritans. They may also decide to donate part of their organ or an organ just for the benefit of other people suffering from serious organ disease. So basically putting together such good Samaritans and deceased donors are going to ensure that we can get even higher efficiency levels in such clearing houses. So that's it. The short answer is, maybe I gave it too long of an answer. The short answer is that it will improve, it will lead to an improvement in efficiency. But this is something that we haven't looked at yet and considered as the next step in this research agenda.
There is a related question from Maria Ospnikova that's on some kind of on about dynamic setup. Is that perhaps again looking ahead a little bit. But would the one could be able to increase efficiency or perhaps consider other issues that if one considers dynamic setup?
It is perfect. That's another very good question. So one of the simplifications that we have done in this paper, we are looking at a static model in the sense that we assume that we have this collection of agents and it's a one-shot question. We're going to try to find good ways of matching this fixed given collection of agents. Actually, in real life, there is dynamic trade-off as well, as suggested by the question, in the sense that if you, the collection of patient donor pairs that a clearinghouse faces, it depends actually on when they do implement the matching mechanism. So for example, if you wait, so suppose you leave this given set of patient donor pairs already in the clearinghouse, if you wait a little more, maybe you'll get some more patient donor pairs and it will be perhaps easier to do to achieve more efficient outcomes. With dynamic problems, there is always a trade-off between waiting for more participants or more incompatible pairs to come into the market so that we could achieve a more efficient outcome versus taking a risk of waiting because some of these existing patients may prefer to get the transplant quicker rather than later. So that is also an important question. And there are papers looking at this, especially in the context of kidney exchange. Unfortunately, at this stage, I don't think there are very satisfactory models that incorporate both the static and the dynamic component together. That's an even more important of a question, though, I believe. And this is something that we haven't done here. Although, again, this is an important question.
Right, so please continue.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you very much. They are all thoughtful comments. So this is our setting. And we want our mechanism to satisfy these three objectives. And these are well-known objectives for an economic theorist. Let me try to also explain them. So the first objective is individual rationality. This is something relatively simple to state and easy to achieve. So what this says is that each pair who participates in this decentralized clearinghouse should find it in their benefit to participate. So what do I mean by this? Each pair of patient donor can always opt out of this clearinghouse. Nobody forces them to participate. So for them to have actually an incentive to be taking part in this clearinghouse, they should find the outcome of the mechanism at least as desirable as the no transplantation option. So you could think of this as something trivial, nevertheless, it's a property of the mechanism. And essentially, in this simple framework, what it boils down to is saying that if a pair is unwilling, the mechanism should not match them in a way that the donor donates the riskier right lobe. Goes to this riskier right hepatocrine. That's basically all that this individual rational condition boils down to in this simple example. The second property is Pareto efficiency, in the sense that we want to make participants as well as possible. So we want to come up in a way with a best possible configuration of these pairwise exchanges as possible under this mechanism. And specifically, what they state is that there should not be an alternative specification of pairwise exchanges, again, consistent with these compatibility requirements, that make everybody at least as well off, and some pairs strictly better off compared to the outcome of the mechanism. Because if this was the case, then actually the mechanism is not achieving full efficiency. We could actually improve some pairs without hurting others. And we don't want it to be this case. We want that mechanism to be as efficient as possible. And the third property is perhaps the most subtle property of all. This is called the incentive compatibility property. And economists are very familiar with incentive compatibility notions. And this is in particular known as dominant strategy incentive compatibility. And the general idea is the following. In the mechanism, as we mentioned, the clearinghouse administrator does not directly observe the preferences of these agents. So whether they are willing, or the preferences of these pairs, that is, whether they are willing or not. So, but the mechanism takes the announcements of these pairs as an input. So we are going to ask the participating pairs whether they are willing or not. And as a function of these announcements, we'll use that announcement data in calculating our eventual collection of pairwise exchanges. And incentive compatibility says that every pair should find the outcome of the mechanism when the pair reports truthfully at least as good as the outcome of the mechanism when they lie about their preferences. That is, again, a natural thing to expect because assuming that each pair really tries to maximize that pair's benefit, if somehow the mechanism is not well designed and gives incentives to people to lie, then actual rational people might lie. So, and again, in this simple example, this boils down, this incentive compatibility requirement boils down to the following. If a pair announces that they are willing, so suppose that the pair announces that they are willing, and when they say that they are willing, they are matched or participate in an exchange donating left fore. And suppose that when they say they are unwilling, they are unmatched. So such a situation will be incompatible with incentive compatibility. Why is that? Because when that pair, in fact, is unwilling, by saying that they are willing, they do improve their positions, right? Because suppose that is a pair, again, going back to my sister and I, we are unwilling in the sense that as a pair, we discussed and we weighed pros and cons, and we decided that she's not going to take the risk of right hepatotomy operation for me to get a transplantation. So we are in fact unwilling. But when the mechanism or the clearinghouse administrator asks us our preferences, if we say that we are willing, the center allows this administrator matches us through an exchange where my sister donates her left lung. If this is the case, then actually we do have an incentive to lie. If you know, when we say that we are unwilling, we are unmatched. And so we want to rule out such situations. We want to make sure that everybody, every pair has an incentive to report their preferences truthfully. And in the paper, we actually introduced such a matching mechanism that works under very general conditions. But let's look at an example to illustrate how this mechanism looks like at this within a special context and try to give some ideas. So here's an illustrative example. So I may be a little bit going slowly, so feel free to interrupt me, Sergey, you know, if you feel like, you know, it's I may be able to skip some of this. So let's look at an example. So this is going to be a very simple example. Let's assume that we have a liberal exchange clearing house in which we have five patient dollar pairs. And here are some simplifications that I'm going to make. I'm going to assume that, of course, these patient donor pairs are incompatible. So direct donation is impossible within each of these pairs. And let's also assume that we have three possible graft sizes. And by graft, I mean the part of an organ. It could be a left lobe, it could be a right lobe, or it could be the size of an organ, the minimum size of an organ needed by a patient. So suppose that we have these three possible sizes that are donated by one, two, and three. Of course, one is small, two is medium, three is large. And the size of a patient, when I say the size of a patient, I'm going to mean the size of the graft required by that patient. And when I talk about the size of a donor, I mean the size of the left lobe of that donor. And let's also make this additional simplifying assumption, saying that suppose the size of the right lobe is one more than the size of the left lobe. So this is intuitively in accordance with our understanding that the right lobe is actually bigger than the left lobe. And suppose that these observable characteristics of these pairs, we have five pairs are giving as listed in this bottom line of the slides. So what this says, for instance, so this is the first pair. The first individual represents the patient, and the second part represents the donor. So what this says is that the patient of this pair has blood type A and requires a minimum size of a minimum graft size of 3 for a transplantation. It also says that the donor has blood type B and the size of the left lobe of that donor is 1. So in particular, there are multiple reasons for why direct donation is not possible. This donor cannot donate to this patient because they are incompatible blood-wise. And also the donor has, the lobe of the donor, the left lobe of the donor is too little for the patient. And even if actually this donor is willing to donate his right lobe to the patient, that's also not going to be feasible because even the right lobe of this patient, which is 1 plus 1 equals 2 under these assumptions, is too small for the minimum graft size 3 required by this patient. So the other patient donor pairs can be interpreted in a similar way. Now let's look at what we call our compatibility graphs. So now let's just forget about these pictures for a moment. Now remember, each pair has one of two possible preferences. Each pair can be basically willing or unwilling. So if we denote each one of these patient donor pairs by a dot or a node in this graph, so we have five nodes. So here I do illustrate actually four different graphs here. This one, the first graph is this, the second one is that, and so on. Let me use colors to code the preferences of these pairs. So let's use green to denote that a pair is willing, and let's use red to denote that a pair is unwilling. How many combinations of these preferences? In economics, we call them preference profiles, do we have? Well, each pair can have one of two preferences, and we have five pairs, so a total of 2 to the power 5, 32 possible preference profiles are possible. And if you look at things from the perspective of the clearinghouse administrator, as we said, these preferences are private information. That's the same thing as saying that the clearinghouse administrator is colorblind. The clearinghouse administrator, when looking at these graphs, cannot see directly whether each of these pairs is willing or unwilling, and has to rely on the announcements of these patients regarding their pairs' preferences. Now let's look at a few situations. For example, this first graph is a situation in which all pairs are unwilling. So the only individual rational exchanges are those in which donors donate their left lobe. If you look at this, these edges, the black lines, represent pairs who can participate in an exchange. So for example, we do not have a black line between these two nodes, the first two nodes, A3, B1, and B2, A3. And the reason is because although A3, this donor, can directly donate to the patient of this first pair, because they have the same blood type and size, B1 cannot donate to B2 via left lobe donation, because this patient has too little size, it has size of one, whereas the donor requires a minimum size of two. However, if you consider, for example, this edge right here, it is possible for these two pairs to get involved in a pairwise exchange where the donors donate their left lobes, because A3 can clearly donate to A3, and B3 can also donate to B2. In fact, the donor that has type B3 is actually a larger size than required for the patient B2, so that's going to work as well. So if you look at it, if you consider all such pairs, actually you'll see that the only possible pairwise exchanges where donors donate their left lobe under this preference profile are going to be represented by these two edges. However, of course, if some of these pairs are willing, it may increase the possible exchanges. So let's get the second graph right here. So assume now that this first pair right here is a willing pair. What do I mean by this? I mean that the first pair is willing to go through an exchange where their donor donates his or her right lobe. And if you do that, actually, all of a sudden, we have a new edge that appears, right? Because previously, we knew that A3, B1, and B2, A3 couldn't trade beyond if we only restrict attention on left hepatotomy, on left lobe donation. Whereas here, because the reason was that B1 couldn't donate to B2 because B1 was too small for B2. Whereas if B1 decides to donate the right lobe, the size of B1's right lobe is going to be 2 because of the simplifying assumptions that we had. As a result, B1 will be able to donate to B2, and such an exchange will be possible between these two pairs, that A3 donates the left lobe and B1 donates the right lobe to the second pair patient. And similarly, if we add more willing pairs, so suppose, for instance, that now this last pair is also willing, this last pair previously couldn't participate in any exchange where both sides donate a left lobe. Whereas if the donor now donates, is willing to donate the left lobe, that means that we will be able to donate to patients whose sizes, whose blood type is A and whose size is 2, in particular this exchange, between these two pairs is going to be feasible. So as you can see, the more green dots we have in this graph, the more exchanges are going to be possible. So in particular, we will be able to match more people. So in a sense, it is good for people to be willing. Not only does it increase the chances that they can participate in a pairwise exchange, but it also increases the chances that others may be part in a pairwise exchange. Because they increase the exchange possibilities overall for this given market. And here, as I mentioned, there's a lot of preference profiles one could consider, 2^5, 32 preference profiles, even in such a small kind of a toy example. Nevertheless, it actually turns out that these four preference profiles characterize all possible compatibility graphs or feasible and rational pair exchange coefficients, because these three pairs, so this one right here, this one and that one, they do actually have the largest possible size donors. As a result, these pairs are not going to have additional exchange opportunities by donating right lobe. So even if we change these red dots, these three red dots to green dots, they are not going to increase the number of possible exchanges. Okay. All right. Now, one important, one crucial result that we use in figuring out how the matching mechanisms should work is the following lemma in that paper. So what this says is the following. So given every collection of these incompatible pairs, we could order, we could have a priority order over these pairs such that, so what I mean by this order is basically just we have five pairs as you see here. Imagine that, you know, we order them from top to bottom. So that's what we will interpret this as a priority order that will be more clear why we call it a priority order when we look at the matching mechanism. And the priority order is going to have this this property. And what this lemma states that actually you can find such a property priority order generally in any problem, but we will observe also that it holds in this particular example. So what is the property of this priority order that we want? It is so that when you take two pairs, so a total of four individuals, so if we take two pairs, if it's not possible for these two pairs to participate in an exchange only donating left hole, then it is again should be not possible for them to go through an exchange even if the lower priority pair is willing to donate her right hole. So this may sound a little bit awkward at first, but this is going to be a crucial property. So let's see what kind of an order we should have. Again, to repeat, this order, what we call this priority order, has this italic property, and the italic property states that given any two pairs, if it's infeasible for these two pairs to go through an exchange, you donating on the left lobes, then it should be again infeasible for them to go through an exchange, even if the lower priority donor is willing to donate the right lobe. So if you look at this picture right here, again, these four different graphs. So what kind of an order should be? So if we consider the first two pairs right here, now these two pairs cannot participate. It's infeasible for these two pairs to go through an exchange where both pairs donate, both donors donate a left lobe. However, if the first pair's donor is willing to donate the right lobe, then they can actually go through an exchange. So in particular, our order should be such that it should rank the priority, it should give a higher priority this first type than the second type. And what is the reason? Because if we reverse that order, if this type had a higher priority than this type, then we would get a contradiction to that statement, right? Because we have a situation in which these pairs cannot participate in a pairwise exchange, only donating left lobes. But after the lower priority donor is willing to donate right lobe, all of a sudden they can. So we don't want this to be true. As a result, what we want to do is we want to ensure that A3B1, this pair, has a higher priority than B2A3. So even a similar situation is true here as well. So these two pairs are unable to go through a left lobe only exchange, but if the second pair is willing, then they can go through an exchange. Again, this requires that our priority order must be such that it should give a higher priority to this pair than to that pair. And these are the only two restrictions that we have for the priority orders that we can adopt. So in particular, we have to rank, we have to give higher priority to this guy, to this pair, than this pair, and we have to give higher priority to this pair than to this pair. Of course, you can imagine that there's lots of orderings of these five individuals that are consistent with these two restrictions. One particular one that I will choose is this one right here, where the first pair has the highest priority, then comes the second pair, then the third pair, this one right here, then four and five. However, there are other possible priority orders that is consistent with this condition. And if we have time, we can also discuss what would be the effects on the eventual matching of our selection of this priority order at this stage. So if we had chosen a different priority order, it is going to change the eventual structure of the exchanges that we implement and what kind of effects might that have. So that's an interesting, potentially interesting question. We could also talk about that for a minute later. But for now, let's start by assuming such a priority order. Now our mechanism is going to use this priority order. And so I'm going to describe the matching mechanism as an algorithm. So this may look a little bit involved at first, but let me give you perhaps the general idea.
Look, may I ask a quick question? So is this priority order has some kind of, I don't know, intuitive reasoning and explanation behind, or this is a convenient technical construct?
Very good. Yeah, I think that the main intuition behind this priority order is best understood if you look at the mechanism. So in the mechanism, the priority order will be used. So it will be significant aspect of this mechanism will be this priority order. And once we understand the mechanism a little bit, the fact that the priority order satisfies this property will actually imply the incentive compatibility of the mechanism. So perhaps just seeing that will give us the best intuition possible. Other than that, I don't have a very direct intuition for this property. So let me talk about perhaps the priority order a little bit, about the mechanism. So let me give you the general overview of the mechanism, then we can perhaps go through the details a little bit. So the matching mechanism is described, we describe it through an algorithm. So an algorithm, so this first page, the full slide is only the first step of the algorithm, and the algorithm is going to have multiple steps. So in the next page, I'll talk about perhaps the step k, an arbitrary step k of the algorithm. But before we dive into the details of this, what the algorithm is going to do is going to be the following. It is going to try to match pairs following this priority order. So we will start with the highest priority pair, and we will try to see whether we can guarantee that pair an exchange. So the algorithm is going to proceed in this order, as I mentioned. So we are going to start with the highest priority pair. And we will ask ourselves, is it possible to match this pair where this pair's donor donates their left one? So we'll try to do the best possible thing for this pair first. And if we can ensure that, even without asking the preferences of that pair, we will promise that pair that at the end of the algorithm, I promise you that we are going to match you through an exchange where your donor donates her right lung. If that is not possible, so we're going to prove a little theorem within the algorithm showing that, you know, if that is not possible for us to match that pair while the donor is donating their left lung, and only in that case, we're going to ask that pair whether they are willing. So if they are at that stage, if they are unwilling, we have already proved it is impossible to match that pair by donating left lung. So we will say that, well, we are very sorry under these circumstances, it's impossible to match. On the other hand, if they are willing, then we're going to ask ourselves again, now if this pair is willing and they have a larger set of potential exchanges they can participate in. And we will ask ourselves as the mechanism designer, is it possible to match this pair when they donate right vote? And if it is so, then we will promise that pair such an exchange. And if it's not, then actually there is no hope. Unfortunately, it's impossible to match that pair. And we will do that sequentially. So after considering the highest priority pair, and we're trying to do our best, trying to match them in the best possible way, we will proceed to the second highest priority pair and ask the same question to the second highest priority bear, under the additional constraints that we need to keep our promises to the earlier, that we have made in earlier steps. So that is the way in which the algorithm is working. Now, again, if you want to go perhaps a little bit more to the details of the first step, so we're going to start by picking the highest priority pair. And throughout this step, we will assume that every other pair is unbidden. So that is actually quite true. Now, the first question that we ask, again, let's try to do the best thing possible for this highest priority pair. Let's and ask ourselves, if this pair is unwilling, can we still make sure that they participate in an exchange? If the answer is yes, then we just end the algorithm here and promise them an exchange where D donates her left form. And then we go to the second. If it's not possible, then and only in that case, we're going to ask this pair whether they are willing. If they are not willing, we already know that it won't be possible to match them. On the other hand, if they are willing, then we will ask ourselves, can they take part in an individual rational exchange? If the answer is yes, we will promise them an exchange where D donates her right now. And if the pair, if this is not possible, again, it won't be able to, we won't be able to match PD, even if they are willing to donate the right one. And this, even if we go, you know, without going to the second step, as I verbally summarized before, the second step is going to work similar to this. Now we will consider the second highest priority pair. And if we have made any promises in earlier steps, in step one in this case, we are going to have this additional constraint throughout this second step that we need to also respect our earlier promises. Now going back to the this condition on the priority orders. Now, an intuitive way of seeing for why this condition is going to guarantee incentive compatibility is the following. Now, note that in step one, we said that, you know, let's assume that every pair other than PD is unwilling. And then we ask ourselves this question, if also PD is unwilling, can we ensure that PD is part of an individual rational exchange? Now, if the answer is no, at that stage, we have actually proved that it is impossible for this pair to participate in an individual rational exchange, even if subsequently in the algorithm, the other pairs tell us that they are willing. Right, because subsequently in the algorithm, if the other pairs say that they are willing, they might, in principle, increase also possible exchanges that this initial highest priority pair can participate in. However, if the priority order has that earlier property, then even if that lower priority pairs are willing, they are not going to increase exchange possibilities for this original highest priority. So in particular, that property of the priority order ensures that once we know that PD cannot take part in an individual rational exchange when all pairs are unwilling, that actually proves that PD cannot take part in an exchange if it is unwilling, even if all the other pairs are. So that is basically the part of the argument, and that ensures the individual rational incentive compatibility of the mechanism. So this may be a little bit more involved than I intended, but unfortunately, I am unable to simplify the model any further than this. So let's skip this step K and let's look at an example. Let me state the theorem. Again, such a mechanism for any priority order that has that property that we stated in the lemma, this matching mechanism is going to satisfy all of our three objectives, to be individually rational, Pareto efficient, and incentive compatible. So now let's go through some examples to illustrate how this works. So again, using this order 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 that we have over here, let's first assume that the actual preference profile is one in which everybody is, every pair is unwilling. again, you should always think of us as the mechanism designer. Actually, we are unable to see the color of these dots. We cannot see the preferences of these participating pairs. We have to rely on their announcement, but given that that earlier theorem holds, these pairs have an incentive to tell us their announcements truthfully, so that assumption is actually reasonable. So here, we're going to start by considering this first pair here to the priority order. So we'll look at this pair first. So the question that we will ask is, can we match this pair through a pairwise exchange where all donors donate a left lobe? And the answer is no, because we do know that it's impossible to do that. We already constructed this compatibility graph earlier on. So there is no edge pointing from this pair to any other pair. So that means that it is in fact impossible to match this pair to any other pair. And subsequently in the algorithm, actually some of those other pairs, even if they tell us that they are willing, because of the property of that priority structure, we know that it is still going to be impossible to match this pair where B1 donates left one. As a result, we prove to ourselves that it is impossible to match this pair where B1 donates left one. So at that stage, we do ask whether they are willing. And in this, under this preference profile, this pair is not willing since this dot is red. So they're going to say, no, we're not willing. So this algorithm is going to finish the first step by concluding that it will be impossible, unfortunately, to match this pair. And we will proceed to the second pair. Now, once we come to the second pair, we will ask the following question. Is it possible to match this pair through a pairwise exchange where all donors donate a left lobe? And the answer is yes. Actually, there are two possibilities. We can match this pair with that pair, or we can match it with that. So since the answer is yes, what we will say, all right, B2A3, we do promise you that you will be participating in an exchange where you donate your where A3 donates the left lobe. However, we will not specify which particular exchange they will be participating in until the end of the algorithm. So what we have done in step two, we have made one promise. Now we proceed to step three. And in step three, again, it's not possible to match this pair through an exchange where both donors donate LF flow. And this pair is unwilling. So we prove in step three that it's not possible to match this pair ever. And then in step four, we come to this pair right here. And we ask them, keeping our earlier promises, we have so far only made a promise to this pair B2A3 that we will match them by through a left lobe only exchange. Can we also match this pair through only a left lobe exchange? And the answer is yes. In particular, if we implement this exchange right here, we both keep our promise to B2A3, and we'll also be able to match A2B through a left lobe only exchange. And then we go to the fifth step. So now we have made two promises. We go to the final step, to this final pair right here, and we ask them, is it possible to match this pair through a left lobe only exchange, keeping our earlier promises? Well, the answer is no, because keeping our earlier promises implies that we need to match these two pairs, and in that case, we cannot match A2, B2. So this is the result. We have that, you know, under this preference profile. The outcome is going to be that these two pairs will be involved in a left lobe only match. Let me not go through all of them. Perhaps just as an interesting other example, let's go through one final example of this mechanism. So for instance, let's look at this third preference profile. So this is a preference profile where actually this last pair is willing. So again, we will start in order. Similar to the earlier example of the algorithm, we first consider this pair right here. It's impossible to match them through a left lobe only exchange, and they are unwilling. So unfortunately, at the end of step one, we will conclude that it's impossible to match this pair in an individual rational way. Then we go to the second pair here, and we ask ourselves, can we match this pair through a left lobe only exchange? And the answer is yes, as we've seen before. We can implement this exchange or this exchange right here. So we are not going to specify which particular exchange they will be taking part in, except we will have made a promise to them that they will be taking part in an exchange only by donating, by A3 here, donating her left lobe. Now we will go to the third pair. And for the third pair, we do know that it's not possible for this pair to participate in a left lobe only exchange. So what we will ask is, are you willing? So we cannot ensure that you guys participate in the left exchange by donating left lobe, but if you're willing, perhaps we can do something. And in this, under this preference profile, since we have a green dot here, means that actually this pair is willing. And they, as we have seen through this theorem, although we did not prove it, they will have an incentive to report us truthful. So they will tell us that, well, yes, we are a willing pair. Well, in that case, we're going to ask ourselves, can we match this pair through a pairwise exchange where A1 donates his right lobe, also sticking to our earlier promises? The only promise that we have made so far is the promise to B2A3. And the answer is yes. So this particular matching that you see here is actually going to do that. And steps 4 and 5, actually, we don't have to do anything because the only matching that is consistent with the promises that we've done, we made so far, is going to be this particular matching. So the 4th and 5th steps of the algorithm are going to proceed in a trivial way. So similarly, we can see the workings of the algorithm if you consider different profiles. So hopefully this illustrates a little bit how the mechanism works and at least give us an intuition for why it gives incentives for these participating pairs to reveal their preferences to them. Now, I want to conclude the presentation. I'm actually way over time than compared to what I estimated. I want to conclude by talking a little bit about potential gains from this algorithm. So here we do make some simulations. So what we're doing here is basically, we're going to compare four possible mechanisms. And as you see, there are three graphs here. And these are simulations in which we have 100 participating pairs. So K equals to 100. And these are averages from a large number of simulations. We will consider four matching mechanisms, one of them being the mechanism that we suggest. And we're going to ask ourselves, you know, what is the total number of transplants under these four mechanisms? What is the left lobe transplants? And what is the number of right lobe transplants under these four different mechanisms? And how do we make these simulations? Well, what we do is basically we generate the physical aspects using data that we have from South Korea. So these physical aspects of these pairs are generated randomly using these physical components, calibrating to these average parameters in South Korea. However, of course, there is no way to calibrate who is willing and who is not. So here as the dependent parameter, we have the fraction of willing agents. So our conclusion may change as a fraction of willing agents in the population. And there is no way for us to know actually how many percent of the participating pairs are going to be willing. It's a subjective assessment. So as a result, we do compare these mechanisms or the number of left lobe, right lobe, and total transplants as a function of the willing fraction. And what are these four mechanisms here? So the four mechanisms is going to be, the first one is quite simple. So the mechanism that you see in the very bottom, this is this trivial mechanism which says that there's no exchange. So we're not going to make any exchange. What does that mean? So how can a pair be matched? Like how can a patient get a transplant if there is no centralized clearinghouse? You can get a you can get a transplant if you're lucky that your donor is compatible with you. So in this very bottom mechanism, the only, there's no centralized clearing house, so there's no exchange, and the only patients who get a transplant are those who are lucky that their patient is compatible with them, and their donor, I'm sorry, is compatible with them. And of course, it is possible that sometimes, you know, a donor cannot donate his left lobe to his patient, but can donate his large lobe to the patient. So as in the example with me and my sister, it is possible that perhaps my sister cannot, we are blood type compatible, but she cannot donate her left lobe because she's too small for me size-wise. However, she might be able to donate me her right lobe. So if we were a willing pair, then she would donate me her right lobe. In particular, the number of donations, even with the, in the absence of this clearing house, may depend on the willing fraction of agents. So that is the reason that, for example, here, the number of left lobe transplants in this, when we don't have any exchange, is of course independent of the willing fraction, but the number of right lobe transplants may be increasing even when you don't have a clearing house. So that is the basically the blue line that you see here. Now, what about the other three mechanisms? The mechanisms on the beta top is actually just a benchmark. So we actually cannot implement that upper bound mechanism. So this is a mechanism that is kind of a hypothetical mechanism where we assume that the clearing house administrator can directly observe the preferences. We do know that that's not possible because preferences are private information, but just for a moment, if we assume that this informational issue is somehow overcome, we can calculate the maximum number of people that we can match, the pairs that we can match. And although that's not a feasible number, so this upper bound, although it's not feasible, it's going to give us basically the maximum that we can do. So it is impossible to do anything better than that. So that upper bound illustrates that. And the thing that is the line that is very close to the upper bound is the matching mechanism that we propose. So luckily, although basically what this picture illustrates is that it is possible to match a number of people that is very close to this theoretical hypothetical upper bound using the mechanism that we've done, we've introduced at least in this simulation. So that is good news. And there's an intermediate mechanism here, the one denoted by the pink line. So this is the mechanism that rules out right lobe donations. So we do have this is the mechanism that we have a clearinghouse that only allows for left lobe donations. So the clearinghouse will never implement an exchange where we have a right lobe donation. So if you look at these numbers, of course, only allowing for left lobe exchanges is better than allowing for, not allowing for any exchange, of course. But it is going to perform worse than both the theoretical upper bound and the mechanism that we introduced in terms of this is the left lobe transplants. And a similar ranking is also holding for the right lobe transplants. And total transplants also preserve a similar order. And in summary, if we have no exchange, so depending on the willing fraction of the participating pairs, we have approximately 12 to 60% of these pairs receive transplants. But if we do use this mechanism that we introduced, there's a potential of approximately a 40% increase in the number of transplants that we can achieve compared to at least no exchange benchmark. So yes, let me stop here and perhaps we can go to the second part of the...
All right, Haluk, thank you very much.
Thank you.
So there is quite a few questions and I would immediately apologize for the audience that I would not be able to ask all of them. And specifically, I will skip all the questions that are medical in nature or that are of economics, but not directly related to the talk. And then I will group actually some of other questions into, you know, the categories. So, but let me start from, you know, more specific or theoretical or relevant to the talk questions into to a bit broader ones. So one is, have you considered or other people considered other types of compatibility, specifically HLA compatibility? I'm not even sure what it is exactly, but I think in English, HLA compatibility. So it's related to other types of liver incompatibility possibilities.
Actually, yes, HLA.
Yes.
Actually, yes. Can you explain this a little bit? So it's not a concept I'm aware of.
You know, I quickly search. So there is this medical concept. Let me see. Human leukocyte antigens.
Oh, I see. I apologize to the, I am certain it's a very good question. I am not in the best position to answer that question. I know that for liver exchange, it is sufficient. So the blood type compatibility and the size compatibility requirement are sufficient for the exchange. Nevertheless, for other organs, the situation may be different. So I don't know this the nature of the HLA compatibility more specifically, but I am aware that, for instance, in kidney exchange, there are other tissue compatibility restrictions. So perhaps this is one of those. So again, I apologize. I'm mainly an economic theorist. Unfortunately, I know very little, as much as basically the research requires about the medical medical aspects of this situation.
All right, so the next question is from Oksana Nyrka from HSC, but basically the question is, what are other possible incentive constraints or possibilities for agents to manipulate not your mechanism, but generally in the markets for exchange? I know, to obtain a better option, perhaps faster exchange.
Very good. Of course, there are two answers that come to my mind directly. So one of the answer is, if you think of a dynamic matching environment that we have considered in this setting, there might be other incentive compatibility issues, because a dynamic mechanism, we need to take into account perhaps the temporal preferences of the given pair as well. So, and extracting that information may lead to different incentive compatibility requirements. As it's done, although it's not directly related to this question, but there's also an issue regarding the hospital incentives to give the correct information to the clearinghouses. So that is also another very interesting issue. It's actually one of the papers in the references that I listed that what I haven't discussed. So this is the this is the paper by Agarwal et al. In the AER, if I'm correct, I'm sorry. So there is also the incentives of actually hospitals revealing the correct physical information that we thought is being observable in this particular paper.
Thank you. And by the way, we provided the reference to your paper that you referred from 2020 in the chat, and then also the questions about the data, Saskarian data. So for those who listen, the details are on the page 40 of that paper. So please take a look. So we don't go into detail there.
Thank you.
Okay. So the next set of, you know, this is now broader type of questions about you know, this organized exchange and transplantations and the functioning of black market. Is that what kind of perhaps lessons or broader implications one can say, about the functioning, co-functioning of possible threat from the bond market. This is the question from Pavel and from Evgeny Lazarev, who is actually working for the medical company, Medsy, how can one, with the help of economic mechanisms, fight the market for back transplants?
That is a very good question as well. Here, my guess would be, if we do introduce mechanisms that make it possible for people to obtain transplant throughout these exchanges through legal frameworks, we would naturally decrease incentives of people to look for alternative methods. But I cannot say much more than that. Of course, this is an actual concern. There are some limitations, for instance. So in Germany, apparently, there are restrictions on exchanges. So the pairwise exchanges are deemed as illegal since they may be a platform for such black markets to carry out their operations, basically money being paid under the rug. But of course, if we do this kind of a transparent way, using a transparent mechanism through a centralized clearinghouse, such possibilities are going to be smaller. So my guess, although this doesn't say a lot, is that the incentives for participation in a black market would be decreased by if we make these alternatives more readily available to the suffering patients and their potential donors.
Right. So, and perhaps the last, but this is a broad question, and this is, actually it's quite a few questions that, on that topic from Svetlana and Zoom, from, Daria Shibitovska, and, others, is about the practical implications, is that, how medical community, reacts to this research, how easy is to convince doctors to perform and engage these operations? What is this, the real impact of the economists on that front? How the governments and the businesses and economists can be, work together to save lives?
That's an excellent question. That is the part that I am not best at, but it is from observation in the kidney exchange. There has been some success of this these theoretical economic studies in encouraging the administrators to structure such centralized clearinghouse markets. For instance, the good example is the New England Clearinghouse for Kidney Exchange that was founded, or that it started a few years after this Rothschild-Mass-Univer series of papers started. So there might be some impact, but when you consider of course, as economic theorists, we also do make research by making lots of assumptions. So it is reasonable, I understand, for doctors or institutions to perhaps question our assumptions when they do want to undertake a completely novel institution. Nevertheless, yes, this process unfortunately goes a little bit slow. Perhaps there are advantages to that, that maybe it increases discussion between the theorist and the practitioner. To be completely honest, that's not a part of the, that I haven't worked on that part of the research. So I haven't directly interacted with hospitals, but there are lots of researchers, Albert perhaps being one of the leading examples who have done that. And we do see the effect of this research on actual markets, although it goes perhaps a little bit slower than one would expect.
All right, so thank you. So it's time to wrap up and time for me to announce whom I think is the kind of who asked the best question and you know, who will receive the prize from our partner Bookmate. And I think that the question that I like the most, and that's actually kind of aims at the heart of the, you know, something that the whole contribution stems from, the analysis and the solutions that overcome accountability issues of variety of kinds. So the question from Oksana Nirka from HSC, who asked about the possibilities and the implications for theoretical manipulation of their preferences and the actions in the market to get better options. So I think this is the most valuable question. And so thank you, Oksana. And a special thanks to Haluk for his wonderful, exciting lecture, for the research that literally saves lives. And this is, I mean, when people ask what is the value from economists, this is it. Economists can help and can save lives directly. But as you see the evidence from simulations, you know, in the better case scenario, you know, saving four times as much lives as one can save only from, you know, direct exchanges. And so thank you, Haluk, and
hope
to see you again. And, you know, hopefully, you know, sometime in the future, you can come and visit Moscow. So thank you for the audience, and I hope to see all of at our future lectures.
Thank you very much.
Bye-bye.